Hello, everyone, and welcome to Biology 111, Foundations of Evolution and Diversity. This is the first course that all biology majors take in our core courses. Our core courses include Biology 111, which you're in today, Biology 112, which is the Foundations of Cell Biology, Biology 211, which is the Foundations of Genetics, and Biology 212, which is the Foundations of Form and Function, and then finally, Biology 213, which is the Foundations of Ecology. Now, all biology majors have to take these courses. In addition, other majors like neuroscience and biochemistry take the first three courses up through genetics. However, if you happen to be a neuroscience student or a biochemistry student, if you take the other two courses, you'll automatically have your minor. So that is something to think about in the future. Now, with this being the first of the core courses, it lays the foundation for the rest of the courses. As biologists, evolution is a core principle to all forms of biology. So it makes sense that this is the first of our five courses. I'd also like to take this opportunity to welcome you to the study of biology. I can't think of a time in our history where it's been a more exciting time to study biology and to become a biologist. All we have to do is look at the newspapers today to see the importance of biology. The growing concerns over global pandemics that kill thousands and thousands of people, such as COVID-19, but there will be others in our future as well. We also see in the world around us the alarm over global climate change. Now, these are just two big concerns that our world is facing, but a firm grasp over the foundations of biology will help us understand and appreciate these two big concerns, amongst other biological questions. So again, welcome to biology and the first of many courses that you will take in our department. I'd like to give you a brief background of the course, what we're going to cover this semester, and then I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking with you about how the course will be taught. And then finally, I'd like to review a few tools that are going to be available to you this semester as we study and learn about evolution and diversity. Okay, let me go ahead and move to my whiteboard now. Okay, let me go ahead and start here with a very brief summary of what we're going to cover this semester. As the name of the course implies, we will certainly spend a lot of time, most of our time, talking about evolution and diversity. I'm going to begin with the diversity part. And I'm going to summarize what we're going to talk about by first drawing what we call a phylogenetic tree. All right, so in this phylogenetic tree that I've drawn here, you see three branches. This first one here in purple, and then the second one here in red, and then the last one down here is our third one. And these three branch points here represent the three domains of life. So in this first one, this is bacteria. And then this red one is archaea. And this last one down here are eukaryota. Now, you may have learned the term prokaryotes to describe both bacteria and archaea. In general, we try to avoid using the word prokaryotes because it implies that bacteria and archaea are very similar. And while they are both single-celled organisms that lack organelles, evolutionarily speaking, they are very different from each other. In fact, what you will learn in this course is that archaea are evolutionarily more similar to eukaryota. Now, eukarya can be broken down into four different kingdoms. They're all still eukaryotes, but they're different kingdoms. So the first one I'm going to branch off here are the protista. Next, I'm going to branch off the plants. The third domain I'm going to branch off here are animals. You and me. And the fourth kingdom are the fungi. So as we go through this semester, we're going to talk about the three domains of life, bacteria, archaea, and eukarya, which I seem to have erased in drawing my other words here. And then we'll talk about the kingdoms within eukarya. Now, all these forms of life here that we see on this phylogenetic tree didn't just magically appear on Earth. It all began with some common ancestor that gave rise to bacteria, archaea, and eukarya. These branch points represent here, say, the common ancestor to all bacteria. Likewise, this branch point represents the common ancestor to all of archaea. Branch point here to all of protista, to plants, to animals, and fungi. But how did this diversification occur? And that's what we're going to spend the first part of the course talking about. That is the principles of evolution and natural selection. How do these principles help explain the speciation that occurred at each of these levels? And I should also point out, even though I drew these rather simplistically, there are many branch points within each of these domains. And of course, even down here, because we're not just all animals, we're different kinds of animals and different kinds of plants, different kinds of protistas, lots of different kinds of protistas, right? And same thing with fungi. How did all of this arise? And it can be explained through the principles of evolution and natural selection. So, Unit 1 of our course will be spent here. Unit 2 of our course will be spent looking at the diversity and adaptations of bacteria and archaea, as well as some general principles of speciation. Unit 3 will be spent with plants. And then Unit 4 will be spent with animals and fungi. So this will be how we will spend the semester. Now I would like to spend a little bit of time talking with you about how the course will be taught. Okay, so let's go ahead and spend some time talking about how you're going to learn this semester. I use an approach called team-based learning. This is a little bit different than a traditional classroom approach where a student sits in a large lecture hall and listens to the professor on the stage go over PowerPoints or other material, and you take those notes down, and then you go home and you study what you were told to study in class. In that approach, students never have an opportunity to study advanced problems in class with the professor or with other students. Team-based learning helps us spend time in class working on some of those more complicated processes and problems. So since this will be a little different process of learning for you, I want to spend a little time talking with you about what team-based learning is. And to do that, we need to spend some time talking about what you're going to do inside of class, and then what you're going to do outside of class. So before each day of class, you will be asked to prepare for class. So what does that mean? One thing I will provide are reading assignments. Now, I personally think it might be a little unfair for me to say, go read chapter 1 or chapter 2 or whichever chapter we're covering the next day and say, come to class and make sure you understand the details of that chapter. After all, you're taking this class to learn. So you may not be able to understand the readings or be able to understand how deep you should go into the readings. What should you be pulling out of that reading? So to help you with that, I'm going to provide two important tools. The first is a study guide. And I'm going to explain the study guide in a little bit more detail in just a moment. I will also provide, for most days, video podcasts. The video podcast will be similar to what you're watching here, where I will explain the main parts of that study guide and what you should be learning for that day's material. And again, I will go over this in a moment in a little bit more detail. So now, what comes after preparing for class? Well, as you might have guessed, this is going to be attending class, right? And in class, we're going to do three things every day except for exam days. We're going to take an individual quiz, and we're going to call these IRATs for two reasons. One, it's a lot shorter to write, and it stands for Individual Readiness Assurance Test. Then, right after the IRAT, you will take a team test, and we call these TRATs, for Team Readiness Assurance Test. Now, these will be short quizzes, each with 5 multiple choice questions. The first, as you might imagine, is taken individually without the help of your team. The second is taken with your team. These questions here will be identical. So what you see in the IRAT will be the same questions you see in the TRAT. And these are just to make sure everyone is ready to participate in that day's learning. Typically speaking, this will take between 10 and 15 minutes, probably a little closer to the 15-minute mark. And so that leaves us at least 30 minutes of that day, the majority of the day, to work on applications. These applications could be complex problems, questions that might be a little more difficult to answer on your own, but within your groups, it becomes more manageable. We also take some time to talk about interesting cases. And questions that prepare you for the exam. As a very general rule, exam questions will be more similar to what you see on the application problems versus what you might see on the IRAT and TRAT multiple choice questions. In a traditional learning environment in a classroom, say, where the professor is standing on the stage lecturing to you, we rarely have time to get to these kinds of problems in a classroom, yet these are the most important kinds of problems. And so using this approach, we can take advantage of that valuable class time to work through some of these more complicated problems, which are often more difficult as students are learning this material. And then what do you do after class? After class, you do two different things. One is I would ask that you, at some point, try to review the material. The sooner you can review the material after class, the more likely it is to kind of sink in. And it will probably help reduce the amount of time you need to study for exams. And then the next thing you have to do is prepare for the next day. And then the cycle repeats. So every day, prepare for class by doing these things here. And then in class, we take the quizzes, work on the application questions, and then you prepare for the next day. Each week, I will provide homework questions. These will mostly be multiple choice or true-false kinds of questions, maybe some matching questions, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. But this is the approach I use in class. I've been using team-based learning since about 2012, 2013. And over that time, what I have learned is that students' exam scores are better, their overall course grades have improved, and I have fewer students getting D's and E's or withdrawing from the class. So I'm confident this method works. It requires some work from you up front so we can do some real learning in the classroom. Now I'd like to go over some tools that are going to be available to you this semester for Biology 111. First, I want to go over Blackboard. Many of you are probably familiar with Blackboard, but I want to show a few things that we will be using this semester. Within Blackboard, you will see where our homework assignments are. I also want to talk with you about a program called IntoDashboard. This is a program we're going to use every day in class, and it's how you're going to take the IRATs, the TRATs, and answer the application questions. And then lastly, I want to talk with you about Microsoft Teams. To talk about these things, I'm going to move to my computer screen. All right, so let's begin by talking about Blackboard. Now, the Blackboard page for our class is still being set up. I still have a few more things to add here, but in general, this is what it's going to look like for you. You'll find your syllabus here, and you need to go over the syllabus before day one, because on day one, we're going to use the syllabus and the language in the syllabus to take our first team-based learning quizzes and application questions. So make sure you look that over so that you're prepared for that first day, for that first day's material. Next, you'll see course materials. You see each of the four units. Most of them are still empty. I'm still putting things in them. But if you go to Unit 1, Foundations of Evolution, you'll see Day 1 and Day 2 and Day 3 and so forth for each day of that unit. Again, most of these folders are empty. But let's go ahead and open up Day 2. So in Day 2, what you'll see is a study guide and a video podcast for that day's material. For every day, there will definitely be a study guide, and most days there will be a video to help you with the material. There might be some days where there's not a video. Let's first look at the study guide. So here is the study guide for day two. For each day, there will be a list of objectives. For this day, there are three learning objectives. And so for this first objective, identify and explain the importance of the five unifying themes of life. So first you'll notice there are these bolded terms here, or phrases. As you're completing this, don't change these. But where you should edit and add to are these areas in italics. These are the questions that you need to know about, for instance, life. This is the question that you need to address for unifying themes of life. This one here, you need to answer these questions to understand why we say life is cellular, and so forth. And so what I would recommend you do is either print this off and handwrite it, or just type it in here, whichever you prefer. The five unifying things of life is that life is cellular, life reproduces, life processes information, and life evolves. That's all that should be in that one. And then, as you'll notice, each of the next five here break down these five unifying themes of life. And so you want to answer all of these questions. You can also put in additional notes here. You could, if you find a picture or a link to help you learn the material, you can slide that in here as well. Once you're done with a particular objective, if you still have any questions about anything on here, like maybe you'll say, I don't understand the Pasteur experiment. And that'll remind you that you need to talk with someone in your group or with me to help you understand what you still don't understand about the Pasteur experiments. Now, you don't turn these in. If you don't ever do a single one of these study guides, that's fine. I'll never know. However, if you don't complete them, it's a good chance you're not going to be ready for that day's material and you're not going to do as well on the exam. So this is really up to you to work on your own. So I don't collect these. I don't grade these. You complete them for your own study purposes. Now, you could find all these answers in your textbook, and I indicate which part of your textbook you should look at. But I also am providing a video podcast for this day so that you can go to that. And that should also help you answer all of these questions. In the past, students have told me that they like to watch the video podcast first and take notes from the video podcast. And then they come to the note-taking guide here, the study guide here, and see if they can answer these questions from what they took from the video podcast. Anything they can answer, they then go to the book. I think that's a pretty good approach, but it's really up to you how you want to prepare and learn the material. Now, as I said, there's a video to help you with this study guide. So let's click on that real quick. So there is a good chance that you've already discovered how to find the video podcast because you're watching this one. So this is a better example of what you're going to see on a day-to-day basis, right? So for instance, if you look here, I go over the five unifying themes to be living, and then I go over each one. Life is cellular. Then I go over life reproduces itself, and so forth. This is why going over the video podcast often is a good place to start and then finish with the readings as you complete the study guides. Next, let me show you where the homework is. For each week, there will be homework questions. I will make these available on Sundays at 8 a.m. of that week, and they are due on Fridays at 11:59 p.m. As you work on these, I want you to know that there are 10 questions, but they come from a pool of questions. So if you're working with someone else, which I encourage you to work in groups as you complete these questions, that's perfectly fine and encouraged. But you should know that the person sitting next to you may not have the same set of questions. There will probably be some overlap, but it's not going to be the exact same questions. But as I said, you should work on this with others. You can use your notes and your textbook. That's perfectly legal and encouraged. And so what you'll do is you'll click on this, and you'll hit begin, and then here are your questions. So to pass Biology 111, you must pass both the lecture and the lab, true or false. So you'll answer that. And there are 10 questions here, and as I mentioned, they may not be the same 10 questions as your study partner. Okay, let's go ahead and move to the next tool that you have available to you, and that is Inta Dashboard. Once you have enrolled in Inta Dashboard, you can go ahead and click on this link. But before you can do that, you have to enroll in Inta Dashboard. And you should have received an email, and if you haven't received it yet, you'll receive it soon, that will help you enroll into the Inta Dashboard. So when you do receive the email, this is what it will look like. It will say activate your Into Dashboard student account, and then all you do is click on activate my account. It will then take you to this place here where you have to enter in a password, and you have to follow these rules that I'm sure you're all familiar with, and then you click reset your password. Once you do that, it should take you to your Into Dashboard page. And let me show you what that will look like. It will look something like this. This is the sample student page I use. And so it has a lot of questions in it from the many different classes I use this with. So yours won't have quite as many on there, but I did want to walk you through an example. I'm going to use this one here. It's question one, and it says it's ongoing. So that means that the instructor, myself, has made it available. So for every class, I'll first begin with some announcements, and then you'll open up your Into Dashboard page and find the question for that day, and you'll click on start. And you'll have five questions, but this is just one question that I'm providing for you to give you an example of how you will answer these questions. So what food has Dr. Gorsuch never eaten? Well, maybe you're confident that it's chocolate, and so you put it all on chocolate. So you can divide up your points is what I'm trying to say here. And since there are four choices, you have four portions that you can divvy up between these four choices. However, let's say you're not sure, or let's say you think it's either chocolate or cereal. So you're going to put two on each, and that's fine. Now, if it turns out the answer is chocolate, then you will get 50% of the points for that question. Or if it turns out it's cereal, you'll get 50%. If it's salad or steak, you won't get any point. Again, if you think it's all chocolate, you're sure it's chocolate, put all four there, because then you'll get 100% of those points if you're correct. If you're wrong, you don't get any. But let's say you have a question and you're like, I have absolutely no idea. But you want to make sure you get some points, because a quarter of a point is better than no points. And so you put one proportion on each of these choices. And that way you're assured to get at least a quarter of the points possible. And then you have to hit, and if you don't do this, the answer doesn't get recorded. So make sure you hit save my answer. You'll also know there's a timer up here. Usually you have 5 minutes to complete these quizzes. And so keep an eye on that, because you don't want the time to run out. Now, if you only hit save my answer, that's not quite good enough. You also have to hit submit test. You can either click on this one or this one. It doesn't matter which one. It'll make sure that you're ready to submit, and you hit yes, and now it's submitted, and it's done. Okay, so now we go back to your page of questions here, and now we're ready to take the T-RAT. So you see T-RAT here, and then all you do is hit start. Now, you don't hit start, though, until everyone is in their groups in the Teams page. Okay, so if you hit start too early, then your team will have less time to answer the question. So you don't want to make that mistake. But I'm going to go ahead and hit start. And we're going to presume I'm in a team and we're in the Teams page. And so the four or five of us will discuss this question and try to come up with the best answer here that we think is correct. And let's say the group has decided that chocolate is the best answer. So let's click that as our answer. Nope, it's wrong. However, with the team test, you get to keep answering it until you get it correct. However, each attempt, you don't get as many points. So for instance, if chocolate was correct, you'd get 100% of those points. The next attempt will only be worth 50% of the points. And so I click steak and hit save my answer, and it's also wrong. Well, it's either cereal or salad, so let's go with cereal. Maybe Dr. Gorsuch has never eaten cereal. Now if I get it right on this time, I'm only going to get 25% of the points available. So now I have to hit save my answer, and that's the correct answer. Turns out I've never eaten cereal. And so this is an example of how a team test would work. Now usually when you work together, the team test average tends to be a lot higher than the individual test average because you're working as a team. Again, once you're done and you have the correct answer, you only got a quarter of the points, but that's better than none. You have to make sure you hit submit test. And once you hit submit test, it will tell you the choices you pick B, A, and C, and then eventually C was the correct answer. If by chance you want to clarify it, you can hit this. Now, I think in general, when you request the clarification, I don't get this immediate pop-up saying you have a question. So sometimes that's not the best way to do it. It's probably better to send a question in Teams in the chat function, and I'll go over that later. So now we go back to our original questions. And remember, after you do the individual tests and the team tests, it's time to go into the applications. All right, and you'll see that the application question, it's ongoing, so that means I've made it available, and all you have to do is click start. Now, often the application questions will not be a multiple choice question, but rather some kind of a longer short answer question. In this case here, I just put upload picture, because I want to show you how you upload a picture, but as you can imagine, the questions are going to be a little bit more elaborate than upload a picture. But uploading a picture is something that can creates some confusion, so I thought it would be a good idea to show you how to upload a picture. You can always type something here. In fact, it's probably a good idea to type something here and go, here is the picture. And now you have to add the picture. And to add the picture, you click on Add Elaboration. And then you click on Attachment. And then you click on Files to Upload. And so let's say you have, your team has been working on a problem using the whiteboard application on Teams, and you've taken a picture of that and you saved it to your desktop. And now you want to upload that. So I'm going to just take a picture of this screen here, and I'm going to upload that. So now let's upload it because it's saved to my desktop. And I click on Screenshot because that's the one I want to upload. I click on Open, and there it is. If I want to edit it, I can't edit the picture, but you can edit what you want to add, upload instead of this picture. But that's the one I want to upload. So now I click Upload, and now I click Save Elaboration, so it saves this picture. And then you have to, as always, click on Save My Answer, and then click on Submit Test. And it'll ask you if you're sure you want to submit test, and you say yes, and you submit the test. And now you're done with that application question. Now, in a typical class time, then what will happen is we'll come back to the main room and discuss that application question. Now, let me also show you what I see as an instructor for the pictures. So I can see that Team 1, which I'm in here, has uploaded this picture. And I can easily now look at the picture you uploaded, like so. So this turns out to be a very convenient way for you to work on whiteboards or virtual whiteboards and upload those pictures so I can see what you're working on. It works out really well, and once you get the hang of uploading these pictures, it really is not that bad at all. And I think you'll adjust to the Into Dashboard and the different parts of team-based learning pretty quickly.
Now the last tool I want to talk with you about is the tool that we're going to use to meet every day for class, and that is Microsoft Teams. Some of you may have used it last semester, or some of you may have used WebEx. It's pretty similar to WebEx, but I think the features in Microsoft Teams works a little bit better for the setup of our course. Now, to explain Microsoft Teams, I'm going to have a second video that goes over that. I created an introduction to Microsoft Teams for my genetics class, Biology 211. And we're going to use Teams in the exact same way that we used it for Biology 211. So I'm just going to use that video instead of making a new video. So that video will also be on Blackboard for day one, the same place where you saw this video. As you watch that video, you'll see how we're going to use Teams in this class and how to move back and forth between the different channels that you will use. As you watch it, recognize that I will be talking about genetics in that video in Biology 211, but it applies the same for Biology 111 and all of you. So thank you for watching this video and learning more about the course and how we're going to learn the material this semester and the tools available to you. I look forward to getting to know each of you throughout the semester. And if you have any questions at all over this material or any material throughout the semester, please do not hesitate to reach out to me. Bye for now, and I'll see you in class.